Hello, I'm Monica Haldar and welcome to The Secrets of How to Cook Indian Food, where I'll be bringing you the tips, tricks and techniques that you need to cook delicious Indian dishes at home. 10 years ago, I started a pop-up Indian restaurant from home with my mum. I now run 2 Indian cookery schools where I teach my students face-to-face and online exactly how to cook delicious Indian food from their home kitchens. I now can't wait to share some of this knowledge with you. In episode 4, we focus on how to cook tadka dal. In this lesson, we're delving into the delicious world of Indian bread. I'm going to teach you how to make 3 different breads from 1 simple dough. So let's talk about the dough. It's very simple. It has 2 ingredients, so it doesn't get much more simple than that. So the first thing is the flour. Now this is chapati flour. This is also called atta. So when you go to the supermarket, you might see atta or chapati flour. It's a wholemeal flour and it comes in lots of different varieties. You can get brown, white, coarse, fine, medium. Don't worry about that too much. Whatever you can get your hands on is fine. The one that I like to go for, if you're asking for my personal preference, is one that's called chakki atta. And chakki refers to this chapati flour being stone ground. It's got a very, very fine meal and creates a nice smooth and pliable dough. But don't get too confused. Just get your hands on whatever you can get to get started. So let's start making the dough. Now I've got about a cup's worth of flour here, and that's about 120 grams. Typically at home, we do not measure things. We just do things by eye measurement, so a bit of flour and a bit of water. But if you're new to making breads, I do like to give a bit of a guide. So about 120 grams, this will make about 4 different breads, 3 to 4. And to this, when you're making this dough, you want about half the amount in water. So if you've got a cup of dough, you're gonna go for about half a cup of water. It can vary slightly if you have a different brand or a different type of chapati flour. If yours is slightly coarser, you might need a bit more water, but we will go by how this dough feels and I'm going to show you what to look out for when you make this dough, okay? So ideally we want to use warm water. That will help us create a nice soft dough. For the purposes of teaching you, I'm going to pop it in a half measuring cup here. Ordinarily at home, it would just be a case of gauging by eye. So this is about 120 mils or so, and we're not going to add all of this at once. We're going to go gradually. And I'm gonna hold the water in my left hand and I wanna use my fingers to mix everything together. So just adding a little bit at a time. We're now gonna use our fingers to bring the water and flour together. Now it's a good idea to use a wide tray or a big bowl for this. And you can see very quickly that the flour is beginning to clump up, which is great. We're gonna continue to add water until all we can see is just clumps and there's no more dry flour. So just adding a little bit at a time. Because this is just 2 ingredients, it just comes together so quickly. So we can see now that there is no dry flour. There's just clumps of the dough, which is perfect. I'm going to add just the tiniest little bit of water into my hand here, and the aim now is to bring all of these clumps together to create one big soft dough. And this dough should not be overly sticky, but it should definitely have a little bit of tackiness to it. So really use this dough now to pick up everything in the tray. It should be a fairly clean looking tray and your hands should be fairly clean as well. This is still slightly on the drier side, so what I'm going to do now is just literally dip my fingers in the water and work it into the dough. So it should be a dough that's slightly soft, slightly tacky, slightly sticky, but not so tacky that you can't handle it and that it's making everything a mess and it's sticking to your hands. So now is the time that we can see we've got this nice dough. It's definitely got a little bit of a sticky element to it, which is perfect. It's nice and soft. So we're going to give this dough a knead now, and to help us with that, it's a good idea just to use a tiny little bit of oil. You don't want to use too much because it will become incredibly difficult to handle the dough. So just enough so it becomes easy to knead the dough. So you want to use a combination of your fist and your heel and work that dough, fold it over a couple of times and continue to knead it. And you want to do that for about 60 seconds, that's all it needs. I haven't actually used a whole half cup. There's probably about a tablespoon or two left in here of water. Now, of course, like I mentioned before, we do not measure things at home. It's just a case of kneading until we know that yes, this dough is soft, it's tacky, then we know that this is perfect. But if you are doing this for the first time, know that it's roughly around about a half cup, but not exactly. It could be minus or plus a couple of tablespoons here or there. So now that our dough is ready, it's important that we cover it, and that's going to stop it from forming a crust. So a damp tea towel or cling film will work really well. So let's pop this to the side just for now. So our dough has been resting for about 10 to 15 minutes. So what we need to do now is give it a quick re-knead, just for about 30 seconds. So I'm going to go in again with a little bit of oil, just to make sure my hands are very, very lightly greased. And we're going to do what we did before, combination of using our fist and also our heel. We always tend to hold the ball with one hand and use just one hand to do the kneading. In Western cookery, when we're baking or using our hands to make breads, we often see people go in with both hands. But in an Indian kitchen, we use one hand to hold the bowl and one hand to knead or to mix, or you know, one hand to pour more water in. So we always have one hand clean. We're very practical cooks in an Indian kitchen. So I've only been kneading this for a few seconds, and you can already see that it's transforming into this lovely, smooth and pliable dough. So this is perfect. We can see that this is a beautiful, smooth and pliable dough. It's got a little bit of a spring back there as well. Now, if you wanted, if you're not making your bread straight away, you can actually keep this dough in an airtight container in the fridge, and it will keep for a good 3 or 4 days. So if you come home from work and you want to make some fresh Indian breads, you can do so within a matter of minutes. You are literally ready to rock and roll. So now our dough is at this stage, we are going to talk about the three breads that we're going to make. You must be wondering, what three breads? Well, the first one we're going to make are chapatis. These are also known as rotis, and these are the daily bread for millions of Indian people. The second one is paratha. This is a triangle paratha that we're making, which is typically made in the north of India for breakfast. It's nice and buttery. It's like a chapati, but it's cooked with oil, so it's almost like a fried chapati. It's delicious. And the third one is lecha paratha. So this paratha is flaky and it's crisp on the outside and soft on the inside, and it's delicious. So the first bread we're going to focus on is our chapati. This is of course also called roti. So we want to take a nice size dough ball. If you are new to making Indian breads, go smaller on your dough ball, okay, until you feel comfortable. I always tell my students that. Don't get a big dough ball that's becomes quite difficult to handle. Just get a nice small dough ball. The first thing that we want to do is create a nice smooth birra. And that word birra means dough ball in Hindi. And there's two different ways of doing it. If you're new to making Indian breads, the simplest way of doing it is flattening this down and bringing all the edges together and then rolling between your palms to create a nice smooth dough ball. The way that we do it at home, and you'll see lots of Indian cooks do it this way, we kind of create a sausage between our palms and press down and rotate, and you just get faster and faster and faster and faster. And then once you've done that 3 or 4 times, you're basically ironing out any of those creases in the birra. You're then going to roll up between your palms to reveal a nice smooth dough ball. Okay, so either way you get there, that's your base to start off with, a nice smooth birra. And now we're going to press our birra into the flour. This is just chapati flour that I've got here, just basically for dusting. So just make sure you press the dough ball into the flour so it's really well covered. You can use the excess flour to dust your surface. And now we are going to use our palm to press our dough. Let's press this down. We're now going to start rolling. Now, this is an Indian rolling pin. Indian rolling pins actually come in lots of shapes and sizes depending on what region you're in. So this is more of a North Indian Punjabi style rolling pin. You get some that look like a pencil and they're Gujarati. A lot of them are tapered or they have handles, and that helps you to apply an even amount of pressure to your chapati. Now, I'm not telling you that you have to go out shopping and buy a new rolling pin to make Indian breads. Of course not. I mean, I've used a wine bottle at times when I've had to, you know, make breads and I've not got my own rolling pin. So, you know, use what you have at home. But I'm just telling you, these are the little tools that you'll see in Indian kitchens that will help you. So the first thing that we're gonna do is apply a little bit of pressure to our chapati. I can see this chapati is not sticking to my surface, which is really important. And we wanna get this about 5 to 6 centimeters in diameter. Now, sometimes if you feel like your chapati is sticking to the surface at this stage, this is the time that you can add it back to the flour or you can dust your surface again. Mine's okay though, mine's not sticking. So this is the time that we wanna really focus on the edges of our chapati. So the top, the left, the bottom, the right. And you can see that my chapati here is actually rotating as I roll out my chapati. Now, if yours doesn't rotate on its own, do not worry, okay? This has taken me years to perfect. I have made hundreds, if not thousands of chapatis in my time. Some of my students get a little bit frantic at this point that my chapati's not moving on its own or it's not perfectly round. Don't worry. You can just pick up your chapati very gently and rotate it and then roll and then rotate. The reason why we do that is to make sure that our chapati is being rolled out nice and evenly. The biggest thing here, more than shape, is making sure the edges are nice and even and thin. That's what you want here. If one edge is thick and the other edge is thin, you know, you're gonna get unevenness in terms of cooking. And so that's the most important thing. The first time that I made my first batch of chapatis, they resemble the shape of continents. So just don't worry, it just takes a bit of practice. So now this is what we're looking for with our chapati. It's perfectly even all the way around and we are ready to cook this off now. So our chapati is all rolled out. It's now time to cook that off. So this is the pan that we're gonna be using to cook all of our breads. This is called a tawa. If you can't get your hands on a tawa, you can use a pancake pan or a crepe pan. Worst comes to worst, you can also use a non-stick frying pan. So we're gonna get this nice and hot. It should be on a moderate heat, so medium to high is good. And then once this is hot, we'll pop our chapati on. So that's great. I can now transfer chapati from the table to our pan. So one thing that's really important is that we flip any excess flour off our chapati. So I just web my fingers and just clap it off. That will make sure that if there is any excess dry flour on a chapati, it doesn't burn on the pan and that can create a really dry chapati. So make sure that, you know, there's not too much excess flour on that. Then we're going to transfer the chapati to our pan. So this is now on a high heat. We're going to keep an eye on this chapati and you'll see the color change ever so slightly. And that's when we know that it's time to turn this chapati over. So you can see that the color is changing slightly, and you can also see that I can easily move the chapati. You can basically see that it's beginning to cook, okay? If you have asbestos fingers, you can use your fingers to just flip this over, or alternatively, you can use a spatula. The best way of doing it safely is just to bring it to the edge of the pan and then flip it over. So that took about 10 seconds or so. We're now looking for the other side to cook nice and evenly. It should be, you will see brown spots begin to appear. Every 10 to 15 seconds, we will just very quickly flip over our chapati, check if it has cooked or not. If it hasn't, we'll flip it back. Okay, I've started to see the brown spots, but it's still looking quite doughy, so that's not quite done yet. We're gonna continue to cook it. Okay, let's check again. Okay, it's still doughy around the edges, so we're gonna continue to cook. So you'll see this a lot, you know, chefs, cooks checking the chapati every few seconds just to make sure it's not burning on the other side. Still a little bit more longer to go. Okay, this is perfect. I've got a tea towel that I've wrapped in some tissue. We're now going to very gently press down the edges and you can see that our chapati just balloons up. That's that hot air, so be careful because that steam inside is very, very hot. We'll just very quickly check the other side. Beautiful, perfectly cooked, brown spots all over. This is now ready. I'm going to finish this with a little bit of ghee. This is optional, you don't have to do this, but why not? Butter adds flavor. So lovely, nice smothering of ghee. And this is Beautiful. It's nice and soft. You can see that's a gorgeous, nice soft chapati. Most Indian homes will have this. This is called a roti dabba, which basically translates as the chapati box. And this keeps your chapatis nice and hot. It's an insulated box, so in goes our chapati. All right, chapati is all done. So now we can move on to bread number two, which is our Punjabi triangle paratha. So we're gonna go for another dough ball. And again, the base is exactly the same as before. We wanna make sure we've got a nice smooth dough ball. And generally speaking, if we are making paratha doughs, if I was just making parathas, ideally, if I'm being a perfectionist and a purist, the dough should be ever so slightly softer than a chapati dough. But don't worry, we're not being purist about it today. We are making three different breads from one dough. So there we go, nice smooth dough ball to begin with. That's gonna go straight back into our flour as it did before. So far, nothing has changed. We're going to flatten down with our palm and we're gonna start rolling again. So we're going to apply a little bit of pressure until it's about 5 to 6 centimeters wide. And again, if yours doesn't rotate on its own, just pick it up very gently and rotate it yourself. So we're not going to make this very big. We're going to keep it quite small. So now it's about 5 centimeters wide. We're going to add a little bit of ghee. This is melted ghee. You can also use melted butter. This is not optional. This is necessary for the paratha to taste delicious. Now this triangle paratha actually originates from Punjab, which is an agricultural state, so there are a lot of farmers there. These parathas were made by housewives for their farmer husbands, so they would feel nice and full on these parathas and then they would go out and work in the fields. So this is a nice sort of hearty bread to have to start your day. Now one thing that is optional is actually adding a little bit of salt and pepper. This is something that my mom used to do. So you can actually just enjoy eating the parathas on their own, maybe with a little dollop of yogurt and some Indian pickles on the side. That's quite a popular way of eating these. Just adds a bit of flavor. This whole scene right now just reminds me of my mom's kitchen at breakfast. So now we're going to fold the paratha in half. So it's a semicircle. And then we're going to fold it again. So we've almost got this sort of cone shape here. So now's the time that we are going to pop this back into our flour. So folding this makes a few layers, which is quite nice. Pat down with your palm. And now we're gonna start rolling this out. Okay, so gentle pressure as we did before. And we're just looking to pick up and rotate. This one won't move on its own, it's too heavy. And we really want the edges to be nice and even as they were for the chapati. So you can now see why this is called the triangle paratha. I mean, in Punjabi homes, they don't call it the triangle paratha. It's just called paratha. Okay, so we're now gonna cook this in a similar way to the chapati. So our pan is now on a nice moderate to high heat. We wanna just flip off any of that excess flour, and then we're gonna very carefully place this onto a hot pan. Now the difference with the paratha is that we do actually cook it with a little bit of oil. We almost fry it, where the chapati required absolutely no oil. It was just a dry pan. So really healthy actually. This is slightly more decadent. So as we did previously with the chapati, we're looking for the color to change slightly and then we'll turn it over. Okay, I can see the color has started to change. And also I can move this paratha quite easily. So now it's time. So just bring that to the edge and flip it over. So now I'm just gonna bring this down to a low to medium heat. We're going to add the oil. So it should be semi-cooked. So half doughy, half cooked, which it is. I'm gonna add a little bit of oil. And you can either use a brush or I'm gonna use a spoon just to spread that oil all over. Flip this over immediately and we're gonna let that fully cook. And we can see that this side is semi-cooked. So we're going to add a little bit of oil to this, spread that all over. This paratha is delicious with a fried egg on top. just a really nice start to the morning, very hearty, decadent way to begin the day. It's the breakfast of champions. Absolutely delicious. So as we did before, we just checked every so often to see if the other side was cooked. And actually, this is now cooked, so it doesn't take long at all. This has got a nice crisp outer. The oil helps to crisp up the paratha. And we're just going to allow the other side to cook. Perfect. So let me just turn that heat down. So beautifully cooked on both sides there. Nice golden crisp skin. And I love that this has the salt and pepper in it as well. You can just eat it on its own. Of course, I'm going to finish this with a little bit of ghee. It's optional always, but I encourage it. You can actually hear how crispy that is. Beautiful. And the nice thing about the paratha, that even though it is crisp on the outside, it still stays nice and soft on the inside. So we're going to transfer this to our roti dabba as well. And often what I do is combine the two together, ghee side up, so that they don't get wet. So in they go. Okay, so we've cooked our chapatis. We've cooked our parathas, which means that we are down to our third bread now, which is our lecha paratha. Now, I purposely left a slightly bigger portion of dough for this because it needs a little bit more. We now need to create a nice smooth dough ball, so just as we did before. Okay, so our dough ball is nice and smooth. We're going to pop that in our flour as we did before. This time when we roll it out, we want to make it a bit bigger and a bit thinner than we've previously done. So using our palm to pat down first, and then we're going to apply quite a bit more pressure to make it nice and thin. Don't worry about the shape too much with this stage on the lecha paratha. Well, you'll see why in just a moment. So the idea here is to get this really quite thin and nice and big. Okay, so we can see that this is a lot bigger and thinner than our previous chapatis. And in this form, it still would be called a chapati, even though it's misshapen. The reason why I've made this one bigger and thinner is because this will help us create lots of layers. So I mentioned before that the word lecha means layers, and we're actually going to create the layers ourselves. So maybe a tiny, tiny bit thinner all over. Okay, I'm happy with that. Now we're going to add our ghee as we did with the previous paratha. So maybe a good couple of teaspoons. And we're also going to add some flour. Now this is what's going to help our layers stick together. So now's the time to get a little bit messy and mix the two together. And now's the time to create our pleats. So we're going to bring this edge to our front edge, and we're going to go this, and we're going to go back to our playground days of creating paper fans. I'm going to go back and forth to create these lovely pleats. The top one should just fold back on over on itself, and then we're going to stretch this out. Okay, lovely. So now we've got our stretched out pleats. We're going to use one end and roll it in. And then this bit at the end, we tuck it in and flatten down. The joy of making breads from scratch is really, it's amazing. I love it. It's easy to go out and buy pre-made Indian breads now, but I think because it's so quick and easy to make this dough, and let's not forget economical too, it just seems like a no-brainer to me to make your own from scratch. So now's the time we're going to roll this out. So just as we did before, making sure that this doesn't stick to our surface, and we are rolling and rotating. You can actually see the layers here. Again, you feel like it's sticking, you can just dust in some flour. So rotate, lift, roll. Okay, so this is perfect now. We don't want to make our paratha too thin. So this is similar thickness to our triangle paratha. And now we're ready to cook this one. Remember to just clap off that excess flour. And now it's time to cook. So pans on a moderate heat, which is lovely. Place that paratha on. And again, we are looking for the colour to change before we flip that over. The thing with mastering cooking Indian breads is to really just practice making these breads over and over again. Okay, I'm gonna flip this one over. That colour has changed. And that's when you can really, you know, get the thickness right, the shape right. But at first, if you are a beginner, don't even worry about the shape. A lot of my students come into my classes and they're fixated on getting perfect round chapatis or paratas. As long as your edges are even and you cook them nicely and it tastes good, that's all that really matters. The rest just comes from practice. I used to stand next to my mum in the kitchen and I'd be the one making the dough and rolling it into the biras. And my mum would just roll, and we came to a point where we were making them for our dining events where we would time it to do a chapati a minute. And we used to have to make hundreds and hundreds of chapatis for service. So you'll get there. After a few hundred, you'll get there. So we're now gonna check, see how it's doing. Lovely. So this is again, semi-cooked as our previous paratha was before we add the oil. So just a little drizzle. Let's carefully flip it over. Lovely. Oh wow, you can already see those layers coming through there. It's gonna be super flaky. Let's oil the other side. Now the lechcha paratha is served in different ways. So obviously as a bread with your favorite meat or vegetable curries, but also it forms the base of a couple of different street food snacks. One in Mumbai called the Frankie and one in Kolkata called the Kati roll. The lechcha paratha is made, then they crack an egg on top of it and it sticks to the bread. And then they add on some tandoori spicy chicken or mutton, then some pickled onions, and they roll it over and they give it to you hot and steamy and spicy. And the bread with the egg and the meat, it's absolutely delicious. So now we've oiled this side, we're going to flip it over. Wow, look how flaky this bread is. It just looks so appetizing. This is why it's one of my favorites. Not only does it look beautiful, but there's flaky layers and buttery inside is just so comforting to eat. You can just tear a little bit off and just have it with a little bit of your favorite curry, and it's just so satisfying. Okay, this is beautiful. It's now time to turn this pan off and serve this up. Like I said, if you don't have asbestos fingers, do use a spatula to flip this over. And finishing touch, we've got to glaze it with some ghee. It's beautiful. Such a simple dough, and we've created three completely different types of bread. One being that simple chapati that you can have every day. It's healthy, it's quick to make. Secondly, we had our triangle paratha, great for breakfast. And then lastly, the super decadent flaky lechcha paratha, which is gonna join the others in our roti dabba. So now you know how to make three completely different Indian breads from one very simple dough. Let's have a look into our roti dabba to see what we made. We have, first of all, our chapati. Then we have our triangle paratha. And then lastly, our lechcha paratha. What an amazing variety. That dough is so simple, quick and easy to make, and you've got a variety of breads to choose from now. So the next time you cook up some fresh Indian food at home and want some breads to accompany, you don't have to rush off to your local supermarket. You've got your flour, you've got your water, and you can rustle up your own fresh ones in a matter of minutes. I hope you've enjoyed this episode of The Secrets of How to Cook Indian Food. Be sure to check out my other episodes too. I'm Monica Haldar, and thank you for watching.